Thank you very much, Eric. So my connection with Eric, you might not know this, but Eric got his PhD from Ohio State University, and we've been on a mission since about 98 to teach Lean, and I'm delighted that Eric is continuing that mission here at the Central Coast. This is really important work that he's doing. And as Eric said, he's part of the Lean Educators Academic Network, where we have educators across the university that are trying to share teaching materials. Because if you think about all of you as customers, you know, you're hiring from Cal Poly and other universities, what you don't want to do is retrain people. You know, you want to hire somebody that's going to be a problem solver right from the get-go. So, you know, if they have A3 thinking, if they understand value stream mapping, those are people that can come into your organization and be, you know, ready and willing and able to contribute to your organization. So as far as an industry outreach, this is really important. And, you know, on behalf of Eric, I would challenge you to say, you know, are you coming back into the classrooms to help with the students, you know, to coach, to open up your facilities for Gemba? Because certainly it's one thing to study Lean, but it's another thing to actually, you know, go and see and offer up your facilities to, you know, a little Kaizen event or a value stream mapping event. So I would challenge you to come back to Eric and say, yeah, I wanna help. I wanna be part of what you're doing at Cal Poly, because it's certainly, you know, very important, and this is not universally being done, you know, at all academic universities. So that's my little pitch. Today, I'm going to talk about cause mapping, which is part of root cause analysis. And I will make sure that you understand this is in the context of the analyze. So when you're working on a project, this would be in the analyze phase of your project. How many of you out there are using A3s? And how many of you have never heard of that? Okay, great. So what I would challenge you, if I actually speak Japanese and don't give a definition, or I'm using a term, you know, please raise your hand, please stop me, and I can answer any questions that you might have. So with that, let me go ahead and get started. Okay, so this is life 101 for PEG. I leave it, you know, a pretty hectic life, and I was telling my table, I actually work in multiple value streams, okay? So sometimes it's really hard to know who the customer is. But life 101, I have an important meeting at the Fisher College of Business. That's our business school at Ohio State. And I have to drop my daughter off at high school on the way to work. Her alarm clock does not go off, and I'm her redundant procedure. I don't know if anybody else here has teenagers, but somehow I'm the redundant procedure. So if the first procedure doesn't work, you know, I'm the secondary, and if I don't work, I get blamed for that, okay? So I have that issue. Halfway to high school, I realized, gosh, I don't have my cell phone. I have to go back and get it. It's voting day, okay? So we have a little bit more traffic than normal at the high school because people are voting at the high school, and there's quite a bit of construction. So I'm late to the meeting. So this is not a good day for PEG, okay? So I start out my day, not a good day. And I don't want to get overly academic, but here's the first quiz. Is the primary cause mechanical failure or human error? I left my cell phone behind, I had to go back and get it. Is it mechanical failure, that the alarm clock failed to go off? Is it the environment? Okay, it's voting day, it's construction. Scheduled expectations, you know, the meeting at the I set those times, or the procedure used. I do the drop-off versus my husband, and if you're married, you gotta figure there's some way in there that I can blame my spouse for this, okay? So I'm thinking it's my husband's fault. What do you guys think? Yeah, it's his fault, okay. We can just kind of stick with that, you know. I went to the Lean Summit and I learned how to blame people. So what do you think? Mechanical failure, human error?
All of it.
All of it, okay. You can see we got that expert crowd here. All of the above, because life is a complex system. So what I want to talk to you today in general is how do you want to think about your system? We'll do root cause analysis, and then we're going to build a couple of cause maps just to whet your appetite for this. So a system defined a group of interacting, interrelated, independent elements that form a complex whole. And we all work in systems. So we have sales and operations systems that help us plan. We have quality systems. And we have systems that, management systems that help us report. But to get to process improvement, you actually have to get to where the work is done, you know, as close as possible. And there's a professor from Harvard, David Upton, and he had this quote that I like to use this all the time. He says, you don't win your customers in the boardroom. You win your customers on your shop floors, at your service counters, in your labs, each and every day of the week. And I really like that because you can set strategy. You guys can all go out and hire McKinsey or, you know, or get the smartest people to give you, this is a really good strategy, but the hard work of executing that strategy is getting your hands dirty and getting down to where that work is, where the service counters are, where your labs are, and actually on your shop floor. Very much like that video that Mike was showing, okay? To actually make change, to reduce lead time, you have to start looking at even that smallest thing. How do I put this label on, okay, to impact? So there's a gentleman I've been studying, and I don't think he's a lean believer, okay? But there's some things that we can learn from him. His name is Charles Barreau, and he wrote a book called Normal Accidents. Now, this is a tomb. This is guaranteed to put you to sleep, but we want to take away some things from what Charles Barreau is telling us. And he has, you know, this idea of system complexity and process failure. So the more complex your system is, the more prone to failure you're going to be. So we want to think about the systems that you work in. Think about what are your opportunities for those systems to have safety, quality, lead time issues, and then discover those and put in place countermeasures to eliminate that. So Charles Perrault breaks things into this nice, really 2x2 grid. That's all academics, you know, this is what we do. We can reduce everything to a nice 2x2 grid. But the first side is this notion of interaction on the top and then coupling on the left. In interaction, when I talk about on the top part of the grid, do you have very tight interactions or very linear interactions? Okay, so if you have complex interactions, I like to think about an emergency room department where you have a lot of equipment, you have nurses and physicians, they're doing rapid handoffs, okay, and they're not necessarily, they can have communication issues, you have a lot of material at one point, and you have a very sick patient, okay? So that's a complex interaction. There's a lot of things going on there at once versus, let's take Anheuser-Busch, you know, where you are on a bottling line, and it's very linear, okay? Things are definitely coming together, the material, the equipment, and the workers, but since it's a linear format, you know, that bottle's moving down the line versus that complex environment where multiple things are coming together at once. So I want you to think in your mind, you know, what do I work in, a really complex system, or are we tend to be more in a linear system? And then we're going to break that up by coupling. And some of you might think of this as inventory. Do you have inventory between stages of your process? So that inventory could be patients, it could be office work, it could be, you know, buffers of inventory that you have on your manufacturing floor, or I hate to use that term, warehouses, but you might have inventory in warehouses. So if you have buffers, large buffers of inventory, you can have a machine breakdown, and it does not impact the rest of your operation. Or you could identify, we had a quality incident, but it's not going to impact the rest of your operations. But the more you lose that coupling, that buffering of inventory, the more opportunity you have to impact the system, okay? Because you don't have a buffer of inventory. So in pharma companies, sometimes they actually package at risk. That means they'll go through and package all their materials while the lab tests are still running, okay? Because they want to reduce inventory as much as possible, but they're willing to take on that risk that, you know, maybe we haven't manufactured this right, but they have such high quality, they'll say, okay, we're going to reduce inventory, package at risk, and wait till we ship that. So think about your vulnerability. Charles Perrow says, your vulnerability to system failure, if you work in the complex environment that is tightly coupled, he says you're prone to a normal accident. Normal accident, okay? And I'm not talking hurricanes, and we can blame some things on weather, but these other, like what happened at the BP oil rig, this is a normal accident, because he's kind of like, yeah, that's really complex. Can't handle that, you're gonna have a normal accident. So I don't like that so much in a lean system, because we're always trying to work against that and understand what our risk is and try to put things in place to reduce risk. But if you're up in this area, you're really prone to a normal accident. And this is gonna be aircraft, nuclear power plants, chemical plants, an ICU in a hospital when you're getting tons of visits per day. Food processing, dams, power grids, I would call these linear, you know, with tight coupling. So if you're making a batch of yogurt, that batch starts and then it's gonna go through all the, you know, pieces and parts of the equipment until it's packaged. So it's very tightly coupled and there's not a lot of inventory in between the stages. You know, once that food processing starts, it tends to continue until you've completed the run. Assembly line production, post office down in here. And then of course I get to put myself over here, complex in the university. You can have an issue in the engineering department, I like to pick on them. And it's not gonna impact your entire university, but you can say it, as a whole, we're a very complex organization. So can all of you see where you are in the system? You know, kind of put yourself in a quadrant with your environment of work. Is anybody having problems with that? Is anybody over there? Oh. Okay. Is anybody over here in the complex, tightly coupled system? Okay, and where do you work? Okay. Healthcare, yeah, very good. Well, increasingly what's happened is through more SKUs, you know, if you're in manufacturing, the marketing, you know, we tend to wanna move this way. We wanna tend to increase our complexity. If we had 10 SKUs 10 years ago, we have 50 SKUs now. Well, all of that serves to move us, as far as interactions, more possible for failure. So directionally, that tends to be where we're going. So I'll give you an example of this. Let's go back in time to the 80s. I love the 80s, okay? So I'm just short of being a baby boomer, and I like to bring that up a lot, especially to my boss, you know? So. And the 80s, you know, had big hair, bands, and you know, all that was really good. So my ideal job would be, if I could go back in time, I'd want to be the Coca-Cola plant manager, okay? Let's just pick 1980. And if I was a Coca-Cola plant manager, because I love Diet Cokes, great drink, and if I was, what's your name?
Darren.
So it's Monday, I'm the Coca-Cola plant manager, and I got big capital expensive equipment, and what do I make? No, what product am I going to make? Diet Coke. Okay, I might make Diet Coke on Monday, but then Tuesday rolls around. What am I going to make? Coke. What do you think I'm going to make on Wednesday? Coke. That's a good answer. Thursday? Coke. See, he's doing very good at the front of the class. So I have over the course of the week, I might have one changeover or two changeovers. That probably take a little bit of time to, you know, clean my tanks and do all this. But I'm going to make Diet Coke, and then I don't know whose idea Tab was, but, you know, if I was a plant manager, I might have gotten rid of it. So I get into my fleet of trucks, and I'm going to go to a customer who in 1980 probably wasn't very sophisticated, and I'm going to load their shelves with some product, okay? And I might come on Friday, I might come on Monday, and I'm going to unload my truck, and I'm going to give them, Darren, Coke, okay? And if there's no Diet Coke, they might not get any, they might get some, but it's a very unsophisticated customer. So my life today at the Coke plant manager, I'm still making Coke, Diet Coke, and I don't know why I'm still making Tab, but I am. But now my facility is a cross dock, okay? So I have to make stuff, and I also have a cross dock where I'm storing Minute Maid and Dasani, and in my facility now where I've made Coke, Diet Coke, we make Coke with lemon, Coke with lime. Darren, what else do I make? Yeah.
Water, vitamin water.
So think about the complexity, and we, you know, marketing's over there thinking of Coke with Jack Daniels, and you know, all of this stuff. They're gonna rum and Coke, you know, that in the future of what Coke is. And at the meantime, you know, I've got all these really annoying customers. Okay. There are other competitors, first of all, other competitors that are coming into my marketplace just making Monster. And then there's the people in the United States that want the Coke that's coming from Mexico because it's made with the real sugar and still in a bottle. So I've got this secret distribution system, you know, that's out there annoying me. So got all this stuff going on. And I have a very sophisticated customer, okay? Can I show up with Coke on my truck? No. Okay. My customer wants every product every day. Every product every day. Oh, that's a little bit more than I get to just put some Coke on a truck. So my life from my dream job in 1980 of being the Coke plant manager to now, if you think about it, I was in this line, I could set up, I could make Coke. All I've done is push and push and push over there until all of a sudden, I'm not as complex as, you know, nuclear power plant, but I have a lot of complexity in terms of setups, in terms of clean out. You know, there's a lot more things that can go wrong with labeling, safety, you know, product movement within the opportunity to not load the truck right, you know, and short a customer. That has increased, you know, 20-fold from where I was. So now I have this complex organization, and I'm much more prone to failure. Now, Charles Perrow says, dude, you're really complex. You're going to have a normal accident. Now, as a manufacturing or a service organization, this is where you have to work against that and say, no, you know, I need to understand the lean system, okay? And what does the lean system tell me? You know, how can I prevent safety, quality, lead time failures with a customer? You know, you have to have a mechanism to expand. Let me understand where I have potentials for failure and then put those lean countermeasures in place. You know, the standard work, the 5S. Those are all the things that we're doing in the lean system that say, yeah, we have a complex environment, but what can we do to reduce that complexity? Okay? So this is a little look at what my environment looks like now. lots of complexity. So again, lots of opportunities to short a customer. Lots of opportunities to not clean out a tank right. You know, because why? It's a really complex environment that we work in. But this is where, you know, Mr. Perot and I disagree, because I say, yeah, you work in a really complex environment. This is why you need lean more, okay? This is why it's so important that you start specifying how work gets done, you start using problem-solving tools so people can understand what the system looks like. So system thinking will help you answer questions. You know, why do we wait so long in an emergency department? Why did the order not arrive late? Why did we not satisfy our customer? So my one thing, if I can get you to leave here today and say, it's not root cause, it's root causes. It's root causes. Because when you have a problem in your facility, service, you know, customer complaint, there's many issues that contributed to that versus one, and you need a system to open it up and say, let me look at the many issues that created that problem and what do we have to do to put in countermeasures. So let me ask you guys, I'll throw this out there and hopefully Scott can get this on tape or I'll repeat it. Hopefully you haven't been to the emergency department in a while, but as a mother of three, I had a frequent flyer for a while, you know, like a card. I'm like, do I get stamped if I come a lot? So, nice, yeah, it's not nice. So if you have spent any time in the emergency department, maybe your healthcare system is better in the state of California than in central Ohio, but a lot of times when you get there, you are the human inventory and you wait and wait and wait. Why do you guys think you wait? Okay, so there's variation in demand of patients. So I actually know that don't go on Sunday nights, okay? Sunday nights is a really bad time because people postpone and they want to come in on Sunday. Why else do you think that we have long lead times through the ED? These are the easy questions.
High variability in individual cases or individual patients.
So we were talking about product families. So, yeah, so if a heart attack comes in, you know, they have very good protocols for this, you know, like 5 minutes, and because you're losing muscle mass, so they kind of have a pit crew mentality on a heart attack versus you're coming in with a sore throat, you know. So they do some segregation of customers. So if, you know, depending on what you get rated, you know, you might wait. Okay, Gordon, you're like at the front of the class. We have other people back here. Again, these are the easy questions. Why else do we wait? Staffing? Absolutely. Okay. Because we don't have enough staff. Okay, so you might not know this, but beds is a huge issue. So this is the system, okay? So if you're sitting down in the ED and you could be waiting for a bed to get admitted into the hospital, I would say, I think at the OSU Medical Center, 60% of our patients actually come through the emergency department, okay? So you're sitting in the emergency department, you're waiting for a bed upstairs. Well, that means, guess what? There's a whole other process to get somebody out of that bed. You know, did they get out? Did they get their papers? You know, when is their transport? And then I don't talk about the whole little transportation system within the hospital, okay, that you call them and how long do you wait for them to transfer you to a bed? Okay, you guys are, you got a little start. Keep going.
Multiple process handovers.
And you know what? And I honestly, you know, technology is going to really help us there, right? So we're going to spend millions of dollars on Epic, and this is like the MRP systems of hospitals that are going to make us all, you know, work very fast. So that was sarcasm from Ohio. What else? You guys don't have any more? How about lab work? coming back.
Fixed capacity of equipment.
Yeah.
So MRIs, CAT scans, you've got a fixed capacity. You probably have one, but you could have a waiting line if that's fixed.
Yeah. So I worked on the ED at Ohio State. We have a pretty substantial medical center, and I think a good turnaround is about 2 hours. That's good. We're like way over six, okay? And then you could start, so there's a gap, okay? Just even thinking about taking a couple hours out of it. But if you look, you could say, you know, there's 5 minutes is, you know, because of lab work, and an hour could be because our residents like to batch their, when they go talk to the physician, so they batch, and then the physician batches, and then they send a batch to transportation, and then there's another 20 minutes that are, you know, related to trying to find a bed upstairs in the hospital to get somebody in. But it's interesting, because when you get the team together, everybody thinks, I know what it is. It's those transportation people. So it's materials people, because they don't keep our room stock, so we're looking for materials. It's the physicians, because they batch. Guess what? It is. It's all of that. It's batching. It's the care. It's, you know, the capacity of our organization. It's all of those things. So until you open it up and look at that, you can't attack the problem and begin to start putting countermeasures in place. But you want to create a system where everybody can see it's this and this and this, and stop the blaming. That's really what we want to do. I still want to blame my husband occasionally, but you know, we want to stop the blaming, you know, that's going on in organizations. I think there is some of that, and we can, you know, attempt to understand that. But when you have, and I've seen this, physicians running around looking for wheelchairs. Physicians, this is, you know, say, who is my highest dollar associate right now, you know, in the ED? And they're running around trying to find materials, okay, because materials are not stored. We don't have a good safety stock program, you know. All of those things, like, I want to eliminate all of that. So, and then if we say, hey, I want to observe for an hour versus, you know, you're just here because we don't have your lab work back, you know. Yeah. Yeah, and I don't know, is anybody here in healthcare? Yeah, I don't believe for all the if there's students in here, we can't do enough to have students ready to work in that industry, you know, that it's gonna be very necessary. So the whole point of this is to say, look, you work in a system, and I wanna show you something that'll get people thinking about, there's not one problem here. There's multiple problems. We have to think of multiple countermeasures. And I want to go back to what Mike was saying in his presentation when he was, you're getting ready for a Kaizen event. So much of this is about communication, you know. And this is just a method, what I'm going to show you, just to help people be better communicators, to make it visual. Think about the lean system. It's so much of a visual system, because you're trying to take that tacit knowledge that people have and make it explicit. You know, that's what we do with standard work. That's what we do with 5S, you know, all in our offices, in our manufacturing organizations. We make knowledge that resides in people's head explicit with, this is how I want you to do the setup. This is where I want you to store things. I want to make it visual how much inventory we have. So systems thinking, this is kind of contrary to how we grow up, where you say 3 + 4 = 7, the system is on, the system is off. It's Dewey's fault, because you're going to see Dewey here in a second. System thinking says, I want to continue to reduce the risk. And in this case, the risk could be quality failure, safe, you know, lead time failure, cost failure. But I'm going to talk about driving. I have a teenage driver now. Scary. Anybody else have teenage drivers? So your kids aren't driving in the snow, though, okay? So I can one-up you. So systems thinking, if you go back in time, it says, you know, I want to reduce the risk that somebody is going to die, okay, from an automobile accident. And then we had the advent. I think when I was little, there were no seatbelts. So I remember an accident my parents had. I was actually on the lap, on somebody's lap, you know. So we had seatbelts, airbags, crumple zones. And I probably should have kept this just all on the physical part of cars, because there's a whole other thing. You know, there's kind of another node here of drivers. And then, you know, the road and the conditions that you're on. But even now, automobile manufacturers continue to develop technology that makes driving cars a lot safer. I've got my dream. I'm of course, mom, so I'm driving a van, which needs to die soon. So I can be driving an Audi. I don't know. There's no car manufacturers here, right? So in my Audi, my dream car is going to have, what are some of the new features that they have? Yeah, heads-up display. They have, what? Park assist. Can you imagine that? Okay. So there's all kinds of new features in cars to make them better. But there's also, I know in the state of Ohio, rules and regulations to make driving safer. We have I know you guys can't have a no texting, because driving up here from LAX, I saw plenty of people texting and driving. So, but we have laws, I assume you do too, on that you shouldn't text. But we also have laws for teenagers that you can only have two kids in the car if they're under 18. Drive. Do you guys have that here? You know, which is good, because that's going to reduce the risk of something bad happening. So, again, system thinking says many issues. You can attack many nodes of this to make your system better. So, again, root cause. This is such a good analogy. I'll tell my kids, you know, I like to garden, and occasionally I get that domino life going, really busy. I'm like, hey, you're not doing anything all summer. Could you weed the garden for me when you get up at 1 o'clock? So, you know, so they get up at 1, and I'll come home and I'll see, wow, it looks really good, you know? What do you think Jim, what do you think their method is of weeding? If you can guess. Pull the weeds where mom can see them. Okay, that's a good one. What else? What do you think they do? Yeah, because that's really effective, right? Because when I come home, what do I see? No weeds. No weeds. So we'll just cut them off. And I'm like, no, you know, let me show you what weeding is really like. Okay, you might have to water to get it, that ground kind of wet, and then actually. Let me explain to you, you're going to get dirty doing this, okay? You actually have got to get down on your hands and knees, you know, with a little troll, and you have to get your hands dirty. So none of this is easy. So, you know, you have to have headroom in your organization to be a problem solver. And I think somebody mentioned that with the video that Mike showed. It's like, yeah, management has to give you time to dig up weeds. Because otherwise, you are going to keep popping the tops off your problems and say, yeah, I put some temporary countermeasure in place, but I haven't really dug into this. I need some time, and guess what? I know I'm going to get dirty in the process of getting to where the work is. So you have to think about getting dirty. So root cause analysis, we start on the left, the impact to our goal. Is it a safety goal? Is it a lead time goal? You can have more than one impact. And then you're going to be asking why back. And when you see things that are hooked together with ands, that's when you have multiple conditions that are taking place at the same time. This occurred, and this occurred, and this occurred. We'll talk about ORs in a little bit. So it explains why a particular event occurred and asking questions clearly back through time. So I have a lot of engineers in here. I think this is going to be pretty easy for you guys. Tell me about what does it take to have fire?
Oxygen.
Heat and fuel. Okay, so that's called the fire triangle. Okay, oxygen, heat, and fuel. So we have fires can happen in medical environments as well as manufacturing. You never want to have that. And the reason you want to, again, think about opening this up. We had a fire, and now I want to think about heat and fuel and oxygen, because if I think about it in those terms, if I break it out even more, I can think about potential countermeasures. Well, I want to reduce all sources of heat if I have fuel, okay? Or how can I reduce all sources of oxygen, you know, from this container if we're going to have fuel? And that will protect us. I'm not saying we're not going to have a fire, but it will reduce the risk. So we're going to see a little video here. I hope you guys can see this. There's no sound. With this, I should have buffered it. I apologize. Well, this is buffering. You guys have any questions for me? Pretty straightforward. Okay. I'm not sure why this is not. Well, I don't know if I'd want to wait too long. What you're going to miss here is, I'll describe it. Young lady pulls up and gets out of the car and pumps gas, you know, puts the nozzle in, gets back into the car, gets back out, goes to the nozzle, and what happens? No cell phone. No cell phone is involved in this. Okay. The making of this video.
Static sparks.
Yeah, she actually has a nice sweater on like I have on. She does a little, you know, she gets back out of the car, and when she touches the nozzle, yeah, she creates. What does she create?
Static.
Okay. So what we want to do, let me build out my cause map. So the problem was fire, and there was heat created by static electricity created by a static discharge. So we can expand this a little bit. So there was fuel. Well, there was vapors around that pump that created that. And the air was dry, and she was getting out of the car, and she required no assistance to exit the vehicle. Okay, so she did not ground herself. Okay, so in the state of Ohio, we actually have about 3 gas station fires a year, and they primarily happen between January, February, and March when the air is very dry. Okay, and that, of course, is when people are most likely to do what? Get back in their vehicles. Okay, so, and who gets back in their vehicles, men or women?
Women.
That's right. Okay. And so it's primarily women, and we'll get back in, throw some Cheerios at the kids, you know, or whatever it is. And the fact is that older adults might get back in the vehicle, but they might ground themselves, you know, when they get back out. So it's the fact that we don't ground ourselves, and because we don't need that assistance, you know, pop up out of the vehicle. Well, there's a cause map, okay? We had a fire. Why? Okay, because of all of these. The air was dry. There was fuel around the vapor pump. And when I blow up the cause map, I can start thinking about the many countermeasures. I'm not saying we're never going to have a fire at a pump, but I can start thinking about what can we do to reduce it. Now, I'm sure in the state of Ohio you have some warnings. I think all gas stations have warnings. Okay, so let's have a post a warning. Well, that might stop people. It might not. Okay. In some places, the attendant turns off the pump. You know, if they see you get back in the car, they'll actually turn off the pump. Well, that might be an okay countermeasure, but I don't know if I'd want to rely on the person that's operating the cash register and selling lottery tickets and whatnot, you know, as a sure-proof method. There's vapors around the pump, so we now have much better, you know, handles. And I believe there's some states going back to where you don't have the trigger that, you know, you have to actually stand there. Okay, now, and I know people can get around that, right? Because you can put your gas cap in there. But did you guys think of this? Okay, so, I mean, there's no accounting for, you know, somebody. But this is what you want to start thinking about. Well, we can do this and this and this and you know, try to educate people to continue to parse that away. I don't know if you can see this in the very bottom of the slide. There's a little hand, and I got this from Japan. The Japanese are so visual. Well, you put your hand there to ground yourself. You know, it's like, oh, hey, dummy, ground yourself right here, you know, before you put your hand back on the nozzle. So the whole point of the cause map is say, let me really understand the system that created that fire and start thinking about how can we reduce vapors? How can we educate people? How could I, you know, make sure that we don't get back into the car? You know, all the different things. Because I know all of you could think, well, we could get around that. Somebody could get around that. Well, if they... How can we circumvent that? How can we make it so they don't get around those? So this is probably difficult for you to see. This is an A3. Eric has posted in the other room A3s on the walls that his students created. A3 is a paper size, actually, from England, and it's 11 by 17, but there's some really good books out there, Managing to Learn by John Shook. I think Pascal Dennis has a nice book on getting the right things done that talk about the whole problem solving, you know, and having a method. I think it maps well to DMAIC if you happen to be a culture that is using DMAIC. But it's, you know where the registration table is? Eric has an A3 posted right there with what are the questions are. You know, what's my problem statement? What are my goals? What's the current state? You know, and you create that map and you understand what the current state is. This is, I know what the problem is. I understand the current state. You know, why did that happen? So we're into analyze right here. So I tried to show where on the A3 that you would use a cause map to help you understand more about, you know, what the problems are in your organizations. I think a huge thing with A3s and in our organizations in general is we jump to, we call it, you know, from the left side to the right side of the A3, where you show management and they already have a solution. You know, they think they know what the problem is. They have a surface understanding of what the problem is. You know, popped off the top of that weed, but they didn't get their hands dirty. You know, didn't get down on the ground and really dig up that thistle. You know, where this is about getting your hands dirty, getting on the ground. So what is a good problem for a cause map? If you go out and study this, this is coming out of a lot of special events, okay? BP, you know, plane crash, this would be something that you would see, you know, the NTSB, you know? So if there's a plane crash, they're gonna come in and really try to understand, you know, what were the many factors that led to a failure. So again, this is kind of going back to that Charles Perrow We had a special event occur, Hurricane Katrina, Apollo 13, Three Mile Island. You know, let's build a cause map. A lot of people who would be in EH&S, I don't know if there's any EH&S people in here, but when you have a safety incident and they're kind of tasked with, you know, why did we have this particular safety incident? You know, so very special cause driven. Well, in the lean world, you know, we might not be dealing with something as, you know, catastrophic as this. We're kind of dealing with these chronic issues. I'm chronically late to my customer. We have this chronic quality condition. You know, we don't have a culture of safety in our organization. So I want to talk about both of those. So you kind of have this special cause of variation, and then I look at these chronic conditions, whether it's equipment downtime, IT failure, project delay. And then you can also use the cause map in a very proactive way, okay? And this is what I think Toyota does so well, is that they're constantly thinking about building systems and thinking about how could those systems fail, and putting in countermeasures, you know, for potential failures. How many of you work with or use in your Lean Six Sigma Body Knowledge failure modes effects analysis and FMEA? That's okay, not very many of you. I will show you one. For those of you that are working with FMEA, really on this proactive side, I'm getting into the a failure modes effects analysis, and I will share this with you in a second. So if you're building something, this is reactive. This is 100%. This incident actually happened. There's no guesswork here, okay? This is something that happened. It has a discrete incident. It has a date and time. If something could happen in the future, this gets into this, we call it a failure mode. How could something fail in the future? Okay, and then it's a combination of incidents, our experience, and our history. Why did it happen in the past? When we have causes, they're related with and. This and that happened. If it's something in the future we're trying to prevent, I'm trying to prevent people from getting lost when they come to campus today. You know, this or they could turn the wrong way. You know, they could not have their directions with them. This or this. I was just delighted when I got to campus and Eric had that little Lean Summit sign. Who liked that? You guys like, oh, Eric, Mr. Visual Management. I was like, ah, I'm going to the right place. Okay, prevent me from getting lost as I get here. So these are a combination of risk. Okay, let this just log in. Probably wants to show me that video now. Okay, so let's just think about that chronic condition that you have, whether it's equipment downtime, you might have a lead time issue. You know, think about that, your value stream map. So what you can do, I just use, you know, we have printer problems. Our printer's not working. So sometimes it's a paper jam, sometimes it's out of paper, and then we have other. So the printer is not working, and I start to collect this data. This is a paper jam, or it's out of paper, or the cartridge is empty. And you can follow that paper jam, top guide jam, middle guide jam, bottom guide jam. What I can do when I go back to that paper jam, I can follow one. Let me pick one incident that happened and follow that through the system and build a cause map. So if you have chronic condition with, say, equipment downtime, a quality issue, pick one, get your team together and follow that one. You know, go backwards on that one. What happened? You know, why did we... you know, ship a truck that was less, you know, than what the customer wanted. How did that happen? And when you build a cause map for that one incident, you're going to see what's going on with your system. That's going to reflect your system, okay? And then In this particular case, I've used a proactive. How could a printer break down in the future? If you haven't seen a failure mode's effects analysis before, I'll do a little call out to Morse team here. This is engine room from Morse team, and I think we have a little simple failure modes effects analysis. It's a nice little add-in. And this is what I think Toyota does so well. You know, in companies that have operational excellence, they're thinking about how could something go wrong, okay? So they're always building in countermeasures. So a failure modes effects analysis, if you're not familiar with this, it's used widely in the automotive industry, and I have to assume the aerospace industry. Is that kind of a requirement? In healthcare, okay? So what you do when you're looking at a process, you start thinking, these are the potential ways this could fail. So you could map that from your cause map. These are the potential ways that we could have a failure in our organization. And then you rank them, severity, occurrence, and detection. So the severity is, if I have this failure, how severe? Is it going to be life and death, or is it going to be an annoyed customer? So your team kind of rates that. So what's the probability of occurrence? And this comes from industry heuristics, or the heuristics in your own organization. Think about, you know, Japan when they built that nuclear power plant. You know, what's the probability that we're going to get a tsunami that is going to go over our, you know, barrier and, you know, flood our generators, which were in the basement? Had the generators been up top? And then what's our ability to detect it if something goes wrong? Okay, so once you do this, a failure modes effects analysis, you get a number and you start working on preventing that. And again, this is what operationally excellent companies do. You know, is yeah, it's working right, but how could we dissatisfy our customer? Okay, so how does this relate to the other tools that are available for, and there's many problem-solving tools available. So let me give you an example of a 5-why, because I think it's everybody knows the 5-why. You answer questions backwards, asking why. And I don't think it was ever intended to stop at 5, or, you know, that 5 was the magic number. It was just, how far can you get back to you have an opportunity that we can fix a problem. So in this particular case, I'll share with you, 3 years ago, this is actually December 22nd, I broke my leg running, okay? So you guys aren't from Central Ohio, but I can tell you, running in Central Ohio in December outside, okay, maybe not the smartest. But I like to run, but I fell down and I slipped on ice because there was ice on the path, and there was ice on the path because it was below 32 degrees, and it was below 32 degrees because it was winter. Okay, so that's kind of a very linear 5-why example. So it's winter, I broke my leg because it was winter. Okay, so this is my fishbone, and I assume everybody here is familiar with the fishbone from Ishikawa, where, again, I have one problem statement, broken leg, and I use man-machine material methods. And I have to say, and I know I'm being recorded, but I'm kind of an anti-fishbone person, and I know the fishbone is very much a part of the quality body of knowledge, but you're not linking the causes. So that's one thing. I think it works if you want to do this to get your team primed, get them together to start thinking. But I see people take items off the fishbone and put countermeasures in place without verifying, yeah, that really was a cause, okay? Or that they got all of the causes. So that's just a little history of me and the cause map, or me and the fishbone. My original, I think I was telling this to somebody last night, I was, again, not a big proponent of the fishbone, and when John Shook's book, Managing to Learn, came out, how many people have read that? One, two. Okay, so in his Managing to Learn, he calls it a critical factor tree or critical decision tree, and that's when I was like, this is so much better, you know, this cause map. So hopefully I can get you guys turned on to this. So let me show you why I broke my leg. Okay, so here's a broken leg. Can you guys see that? Yeah. Hey, I will tell you this. I got into the emergency department at 6:30 in the morning, and the person who brought me in, she's a nurse, she said the whole time, she goes, this is a really good time for you to come in to the emergency department. She literally goes, there's no wackos in here right now, you know, it's early in the morning. I'm like, so it's time dependent, you know, it's time dependent on when you come in. So I got in at 6:30 and I was in the operating room by noon. And of course, I'm like, you know, the geek ops person, I was timing everything. But I thought that was pretty good. You know, but there is evidence. So here's the evidence. Yeah, I did break my leg. And what I want you to see is that my safety goal was impacted. And I'm going to go with family harmony. Okay? So there's multiple goals impacted because, yes, I waited to the last minute, okay, to buy Christmas presents. So that day, it was a Friday, I had told my boss, I'm like, I'm not coming in. We had been working really hard up until that point. Like, I gotta go shopping. And I remember thinking, should I go running? Yeah. So this is my fault, though. Okay, I'll put the blame there. Financial goals were impacted, and my health, because, you know, I was non-weight-bearing for about 3 months. I did, you guys are probably not Big Ten basketball fans, but I did watch like an entire season of basketball on the couch. So I was depressed. I ate a lot. So I had all these things that were impacted. But I want to point out, you don't get that from the fishbone because you're only starting with the broken leg. But all of these things come back to the broken leg. Okay? And why did I break my leg? Because I hit a hard surface and, you know, my shoes did not grip, or the stress exceeded the strength. So I fell backwards, my leg was under my body, and I put osteoporosis. So I didn't know if that was an and or an or. So I got to the hospital, I'm like, man, my leg's broken, my ankle's broken, I have to have osteoporosis. You know, so that was this has got to be what caused it. It couldn't be my weight. So I had to go and confirm that, you know, with the physician when they took the x-ray. Can you see that I have osteoporosis? I did not. Okay, so this is where on a cause map, you put all of these things up there, and some of them are ands, and some of them are ors. It could be because I fell backwards and my leg was under my body, and or osteoporosis that my muscle or my bones were weakened, and I confirmed it was not, okay? So you want to put them up there. I stepped on an icy surface and there was ice. Okay, so there's two things there. I didn't see the ice. Why? Because it was dark. So, you know, this is December 22nd, Columbus, Ohio, 5:30 in the morning. I know you're shaking your head. Maybe I should move out here so I could run all the time. I started running at 5:30, and then I put, don't even get me started on this one, because it's like the only modicum of time I could, you know, fit in here. I was not looking down. I was talking to that guy right there. And so below 32 degrees, the path is not salted. And I'll try to move this over a little bit. Here's the path. This is in the daylight when I took this picture. Do you guys think I'm a geek? Darren's like, yeah, you guys are ops people. You should like this. Okay, so here's the path. I'm coming down the path. It's dark. And that shrub blocks the sun. So this path, even though it kind of melts during the day, it's going to refreeze at night. And that little, even though the path was pretty clear, that was there one little bit of ice, and, you know, $25,000 later in healthcare costs, you know, two surgeries. There's my cause map. But that opens it up because now I can say, wow, there's a lot I could do versus it's winter, you know. don't run. What could I do differently? What?
Treadmill.
Okay, I could run on a treadmill. What else? Don't run with Pat. Yeah. Wear a headlamp. Okay, what else?
Remove the tree.
Remove the shrub.
Change your running style.
Change my running style. How would I don't have that on there.
Probably land on your heel.
Yeah, could be.
Different style shoe.
Run in the daylight. Okay. And that's all I want to do with the cause map is say, the pink things are things where I collected evidence. Okay? Yeah, I did break my leg. It was broken, 2 plates, 5 screws. Okay, no, I don't have osteoporosis. And the things in green on the top are my countermeasures. I could wear grippers, I could join a gym, I could wear a headlamp, I could run in the daylight, I could watch where I'm running. I could not run when it's below 32 degrees. So when you go to management and say, wow, here's a bunch of countermeasures, that's going to be way better conversation than, I have one countermeasure for you, management. No, you're going to go to management and you're going to say, gosh, I got lots of countermeasures here for you. Here's the cost of them, and here's the pros and cons of each of those. You know, joining a gym, okay, it's going to be $700 a year. Okay, well, let me evaluate that. I could run, I think Kathy said run in the daylight, right? Well, you know, that's a double setup for me, okay? So if I wait and run it, a lot of people in Columbus will run at lunchtime, okay? But I'm like, you know, hair, this does not magically happen, people. Okay, so. But again, my whole point is I want to open it up big so we can see the many problems, and then I'm going to go to Jim and Darren, and I say, wow, look at this. We could do this and this and this. And they're like, okay, what's the cost of that? You know, how much do we think that is going to reduce the risk of you falling? Does that make sense? Okay, so this is what the things in pink are where I've collected evidence. I think you can see me down here with my, there's my little headlamp right there. So. It's hard to be anti-fishbone, but I really wanted to explain that difference. Cause and effect method, we're going to ask why back through time. So an effect is actually, it has a cause, and that cause becomes an effect. And I want to give you guys a little opportunity to build one real quick. So on each of your tables, there's some sticky pads. So put down on one notepad, Z, W, U, V, you know, you can read those, even in the back, I think. And then I want you to build with the sticky pads a little cause map. This is just to get, this is just with letters, okay? Build a cause map, get your chops going here, and then we're going to do a quality one here in a second. So we'll take 5 minutes. Okay, so one important takeaway here is look at the expensive problem-solving tools that I have given you today, right? You know, think about this. You can solve, you know, deep problems in your organization with my software, okay? Sticky notepad and your team. Does everybody have that? Okay. So we want to get very specific on ours. Bolt broke because too much force was applied to it. Hey, our bolt broke. Why? Excessive force and strength of bolt. Okay. Another royal scandal. You guys remember that one? She's topless. You guys remember that? Not too long ago. Why? A picture was taken and she was topless. Okay. So I kind of blew this one up. I was probably having too much fun with this, but you know, really what it was the French magazine published photos. Why? Because they're going to increase in magazine sales. Why? Because they want to generate revenue for their magazine. And there was nude photos. She was topless and the photographer could see her. You know, so there was multiple things going on there. The photographer knew where she was. There was no barrier, and they had the equipment. So what did the royals try to do? Stop them from being published. Well, that's kind of an after-the-fact thing. And they try to get people to stop buying the magazines. Okay, so that's another. Let's try to do this. Stop the photographer, or maybe I'll take your top off. That's just a peg suggestion. Okay, so we want to define the problem. Okay, when you're doing a cause map and you get everybody together and you said, "Wow, we didn't load our truck right," okay, or we had this quality issue. You know, we have the maintenance department might be there, the quality department, and everybody is coming in with this thought of what the problem is, and you know, who besides them, you know, is the cause of that problem. But we want to work with your team most effectively. Start with the corporate goal that was impacted. You know, did we impact safety? Did we impact quality? Did we impact lead time? Did we impact costs? And you start with those on your left, and there's no disagreement. You know, we dissatisfied a customer, okay? And, you know, we had $10,000 in equipment that, or a product that we had to take back, okay? That, people cannot disagree on that. So if you're in hospital, you know, the things on the left side of your cause map, patient safety, employee, compliance, materials and labor, if it's an industrial, it could be environmental, it could be safety, it could be production. So just some examples. But when you get your team together, start with the corporate goals that were impacted. What was the corporate goal impacted by the sinking of the Titanic? What?
People's lives.
Yeah, people died, okay, because people say, hey, we sank a ship, okay. So, you sank a ship, so you had a corporate asset, okay, that we lost, the loss of the ship, but you also lost 1,500 people. And again, on the cause map, if you're doing a fishbone diagram and you say, we sank the Titanic, you could never get to the fact that there was no lifeboats because you haven't even addressed the problem that you have lost 1,500 people. You'd have to do two different fishbone diagrams for this. So this is another really tough question for you guys. Why did the Titanic sink? It hit an iceberg. Let's go home. It hit an iceberg. Okay, why else did the Titanic sink?
Hubris,
arrogance. Okay, and that arrogance actually was made us want to set a record of crossing the Atlantic. So, well, I'll go with we're going fast. Okay, so we're going fast. We hit an iceberg. What else?
Material properties.
With the bolt.
The steel.
Okay. What else?
The
design of the ship. The bulkheads in the very front of the ship did not go all the way to the top. So when the ship got hit, that allowed the water to go, I think, into the first five bulkheads. Okay, what else?
Too dark.
It was dark out. Okay. Traveling at night. Probably running. Okay, what else?
How about lack of training, disaster training?
Of getting on the lifeboats. Okay, so okay, Titanic sank, ship hit iceberg. Okay, we can all go home. Ship hit iceberg, we couldn't turn quickly enough. Ship hit iceberg. Water filled the hull. There's steel plates buckled in the hull, okay? And there was an iceberg present, which gets to the path that we actually chose to take, okay? So I keep wanting to expand this and blow this up so we can look at, you know, what were the many things, and I have one that's much bigger than this, that caused that and actually caused the loss of the, you know, 1,500 people, because there was, the ship could have sank and we not lose the people, you know, because we could have had better safety procedures that I think you were mentioning, you know, and then more lifeboats, okay? So I want to blow that up and then we can look at, oh, okay, what was the design of the ship? What was the quality of the materials? What was the arrogance that led us to go fast? Why didn't we stop when we knew there was icebergs present in the water? You know, there was many things. So if I show the whole cause map, then I can start putting many different countermeasures in place as opposed to lopping off the top of the weed. I want to get in, get my hands dirty. Does that make sense? Okay, and here's that transitive property. If A caused B and B caused C, then A caused C. So the amount of detail is what you need to get into to solve the problems in your organization. So Brent, I probably should change this to my daughter, had a bad grade. Why? Did not understand the material. Why? Did not spend time studying. Why? Active social schedule. Okay, so here we have that transitive property, but I want to get into this. Hey, you don't understand the material. Let's figure out how can you take more time. You know, let's put in some countermeasure there so that you have effective time to study. And then again, that kind of zooming aspect. If I'm at Ohio State and somebody says, "Hey, how do I get to the airport?" Well, it's just east of town. Like, no, you know, I really need to know what that path is. You're going to get on 315 and then to 670. So I keep wanting to zoom and zoom down into the problem. So be specific. I think this is the hardest part right here. For those of you that are working on these are the ones you don't want to end on. Okay? Human error. Okay? Equipment failure, procedure not followed, poor communication. This is the hardest thing right here. But I would tell you all of these will point back to us as leaders and managers in the system that says we haven't put in the proper processes in place to allow people to build, you know, in a safe environment, to build quality products. So you have to move beyond this. So problem occurred, human error, you know, get beyond this. I want to show you one here. Child required emergency surgery. This is from a children's hospital. Staff did not recognize the decline in patient status. Why? The specialist was on vacation and the other technicians were not trained. So, okay, let's, you know, do training program, everything's going to be okay. Okay, well, this cause map, actually, we could walk away. One second. Oh, I actually have it in here, sorry. This cause map actually looks like this. And I have this on two slides. The child required emergency surgery. Okay, well, let's just look at one part of this, and lean people are going to, your carotid artery is going to just fluctuate here. Staff cannot locate emergency equipment. Can you imagine that? I'm in a hospital, you know, I have a child going down, and we can't find our emergency equipment. Okay, why? Equipment is scattered across the department. Some equipment was locked away in the nursing area, and some of the equipment, they actually thought it was a lunch bag. Okay, so, you know, you have a child's life, you know, life and death, and it comes down to workplace organization, really? Yeah. Remember that complex work environment? Okay, and I talked about healthcare, really complex, lots of handoffs. So what do we have? We have to make it easy for people to do the right thing, okay? And that is all about that workplace organization. Staff did not recognize a decline in the patient's status. Why? There's no monitor present. No one was given specific responsibility to monitor the patient. And interestingly enough, the patient's grandmother was there, and she had a hospital uniform on from another hospital, so people thought she was a staff. And she was given instructions, okay? So there was a huge communication issue, you know, going on here. And then we get down to the specialist was on vacation, and there was no standard work instructions in place. So all of that, let's blame these technicians to, well, how about the management that allowed that poor workplace organization, you know, to maintain itself? How about the management that, you know, really hasn't put people in place that are trained properly, or the management that really hasn't been clear on how do we communicate? Okay, again, we want to be really specific. I push a pencil on the floor, it rolls, it's pushed, it rolled, it was elevated, and there was gravity. You think, oh, that's, you know, pretty innocuous. Who cares about pencils hitting the floor? Well, if you're a second grade teacher, and this happens all the time, then you might say, wow, that is really annoying to me. I don't want these pencils to hit the floor anymore. So what do? We could have pencils that don't roll. We could have desks with holders. We could have kids, make them work on the floor, you know? There's many countermeasures available. But again, when you open up the system, then you can start thinking about the countermeasures. So I'm going to give you guys 10 minutes with your team at your table, and you have notepads there. We had an employee, they finished their work at cell 3, and they were walking to cell 4 when they tripped on a barrier, and it's a little elevated barrier, okay, about 6 inches high. They sprained their ankle during the fall. The employee was carrying 3 boxes of product, which also made it difficult to see where they were going. This employee took a shortcut, okay? So we have cell 3 on the left and then cell 4 on the right. This is the path of the employee. I'm carrying boxes, forklift path, and they didn't take the crosswalk. So from the information I gave you, build a quick cause map. Start with what was the impact, okay? And then when you get into, I don't know this is something I'd want to investigate, you can write down, I have like a hypothesis here, and put a question mark. Okay, because then we say, hey, you need to go back and investigate this further. So 10 minutes with your team. I need to keep going because I'm standing between you and food. And then past experience have told me that that's really critical. So how many of you had that our safety goal was impacted? Okay, so yay. Okay, so if you had that, because, you know, if we have, if Brent is the person that sprained their ankle and we don't start with that, you know, we have that workplace injury, Brent's not going to feel very good in the room. And again, we're going to get the team together. It's really important that you get the team together and look, you know, everybody's going to think, oh, it's because of that barrier. No, it's, you know, because they were carrying boxes. No, it's because we moved from cell 3 to 4. Well, we want to blow all that up. And yours might look a little bit different. Safety goal was impacted. They sprained their ankle, tripped on a barrier. Now, we could have had a productivity goal impacted as well. Did you have that? Productivity goal? Yes. So you could have had safety and, you know, we might have short-shipped a customer because we had this workplace accident. Didn't see the barrier. I was walking to cell 4, and the fact that there is a barrier, yours might look a little bit different than that or expanded. When I'm telling people, if you don't know, like, why were they carrying boxes? You know, maybe the push cart wasn't available, or this is where you want to put, you know, question mark, and then go back and further refine that and ask questions. So it could be an and or an or. The thing is that, you know, as a facilitator, you know, people are going to be calling out stuff to you, and you're going to use this really expensive method here, okay? And write down these causes, and then you can move them around, you know? But again, asking questions backwards through time to come up with the many different causes. So this is pretty easy. I just do it on a whiteboard. Some people, you can actually go in, and I'll leave my Excel templates with Eric. I would start, though, first with notepads. You know, some of you might want Visio, or, you know, make it easy for yourself. But you want to get, how many of you people actually had the barrier as something? Okay, that's good, because, again, as we open up the cause map that says, wow, there's a lot of different, you know, countermeasures here. Now, I'm not a NASCAR fan, okay? I won't qualify that, but when Dale Earnhardt,
I know.
So Dale Earnhardt was driving at a high rate of speed, right, and hit a barrier, okay, and died. But he wasn't wearing a Hans device, which all NASCAR drivers have to wear now. But one of the things they came up with, yeah, he's going to keep driving fast, or these car racers, but what do they have now for barriers? What do you call them?
Safer
barriers or breakaway barriers. So until you start thinking like that, yeah, there is a barrier. Well, gosh, how could we put a countermeasure in place? If you don't show that, you're not going to think of it. Okay. So, yeah, we had a barrier. Do we want to take the barrier out? Do we want to make it, build it so they can't actually, you know, it's a wall. They just run into it. I don't know. But even with the sprained ankle, you could make people wear boots in your organization. So, hey, you might fall, but you don't sprain your ankle because you have a better shoe on. So you validate your causes. You go and collect evidence on your causes, and you take photos, you talk to people, and whatever you do, you don't blame people, okay? And again, you want to reduce that risk. So how many of you, have you ever gotten home and the fries were missing from your bag? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And what do you think when those fries are missing?
They forgot.
Okay. They forgot to put them in the bag and did not check the bag, right? So you're going to say, Peg, you know, you're in a Lean Summit. Are you telling me, you know, that we should add quality inspection? No, I'm just telling you what the system is, okay? If you know, how did that occur? One, the fries were missing. They didn't put it in, and there was no check. Now, I'm not sure what you guys don't have drive-thrus here, so in San Luis Obispo. That's according to the Oprah Winfrey video that I saw before I came here.
They may not have got fries on your order. They may not have
heard you. Yeah. Right, so there's many things, but I want to say, you know, this is the system that actually occurred, okay? So from validating our causes, you know, we go collect evidence of what actually happened, and here you might have to collect data, you know, and use some of your statistical tools, you know, to help you understand what the nature of the problem is. And then we start thinking about countermeasures. And again, think about the Lean system. Everything, you know, in the Lean system is we want to make it visual and we want to make it simplified. So we want to have many countermeasures to show, because again, when we're having those conversations with management, if I bring one countermeasure, Cody's going to be like, well, I don't like that. You know, did you think of this? No. You know, I'm going to show Cody, here are the many potential opportunities, and here's what the impact is. So thinking about going back to the beginning of the presentation, you know, as our organizations increasingly, you know, through niche products, we keep moving over into that complex, the Lean system, even though we try to create tighter couplings by reducing inventory, through the visual management systems, through standard work, we want to move to reduce complexity. So an operator knows, so it's really easy for me to do a changeover because my tooling is right there. It's really easy for me to do a nursing changeover, you know, because we've standardized what our communication is going to be. You know, I'm not going to make a safety incident with medication because we're going to create ways of spelling medication and ways of labeling it that make it really easy for me to see the right thing is done. And then if you think about those countermeasures, 5S, visual management, standard work, TPM, all that good stuff, then you have the whole Lean management system, which is that problem-solving system that, you know, is going to continue to help you build operational excellence, you know, into your organization. You evaluate your countermeasures, many, and then here's the whole project management side of it, which this is kind of the ending of your A3, you know, from Analyze on. And I'm going to show you, just to give you one that I just did this. We had a water main break at Ohio State University, and we're 50,000 students, so we have about 20,000 students that live on campus. And that water main break was at Sunday, 6:30 at night, and so students were evacuated, like 2,000 students were evacuated from this dorm, and of course they're like leaving, you know, going to find places to sleep, which is not what you want for your campus, for your students to be out there wandering around. And then, so I put our employee safety was impacted because of this water main break, academic disruption, blah, blah, blah. So what happened, let me show you. My engineers in here will like this. This joint, if you can see this, it's located in a tunnel. It's about 18 months old, and there's about 100 PSI waters coming, and that joint, the screws weren't in there all the way. There's, I think, about 18 screws around there. Six of them weren't, and that joint gave way, and then it ran and ran and ran because all the buildings that the water was running through, some of them were under construction, and we had no signals underwater. So the very first signal that there was a problem, this is 6:30 on Sunday, was a sump pump in a dorm. So who gets called? Janitors. Where are the janitors? It's a Sunday at 6:30. There's some, no. He's drinking. The janitor's on another call, right? So the janitor comes, and you know, by this time water's filling. And then the janitor comes and says, the problem. So who's the janitor call? Building maintenance. And then building maintenance can't get in because the students don't recognize them and say, we are not allowed to let you in. Okay? And then building maintenance finally gets, so minutes are going by, right? Building maintenance finally gets in, and then who do they have to call? Utilities. Utilities guy is an hour from campus. Oh, shit. Yeah. We're talking millions of dollars of equipment. So there is the joint that separated, and I didn't spend a lot of time on that. I leave that to the attorneys. What I spent all the time with the team was that tunnel was immersed in water, and the power was shut down. Water ran undetected for 17 minutes, and then water ran after it was detected for another 2.5 hours. During that 2.5 hours was, you know, $5 million of damage. Okay, so the guy that called me out just said, hey, I want you to look into this. He's like, he wanted a smoking gun. He's not quite a lean thinker. You know, where's the smoking gun? I'm like, there is no smoking gun. Don't you see that? It was this and this and this, you know. It was the time to locate the isolation valve. So, of course, this is a construction site. For those of you who can't see it, this is an isolation valve that's covered with mud and, at the time, water. So the fire department was there, and there was lots of people running around trying to turn keys, but they weren't the right keys because the drawings weren't updated. Okay, so not only could we not get into the building, but the drawings weren't updated. Where you had drawings that said, here's a curb, well, that really wasn't where the curb was anymore because it was a construction site, okay? So it was this and this and this. So we had 18 people that got together, and people were nervous, you know, about participating in something like that, that they're going to be blamed. I wanted to show you a couple. There's the water key to turn it off, you know, and then people are always afraid to turn the power off, that we're going to turn the power off to a research lab and kill the 20-year-old mice or something, you know. So there's this kind of culture of nobody wants to, you know, do anything too drastic, you know, because that's the whole thing. It's like, we don't want to kill the mice, you know. But in the meantime of not killing the mice, of course, the pumps failed. So I want to show you a picture of the equipment that was. So this is the tunnel here, and then here's all this equipment. So you did a pretty good job, but what we did from this cause map, got the team together and brainstormed all the potential countermeasures. You know, we didn't have an emergency response team because there was no one person in charge of something like this. So it was like, wow, a lot of, you know, things for FEMA, the organization that we took from that. And we said it has to do with mitigation, all the things that were not being done on project design, all the things that we could do from early detection, you know, that once the water, and then if you have a failure, what should your communication protocol be? So from that incident, we said there was about 20 things that we needed to learn, you know, to make our university safer. And as it turned out, water, when I got that team together, water is a pretty common occurrence at Ohio State University. It wasn't like this was big in the amount of damage, but they get calls on this all the time. So it was really necessary. Let's show this one incident and then show the many different things that we could do to reduce the risk of, you know, student issues, and then, of course, the loss of equipment. So it's the cause map. I think it's just takes time to learn to work with it. I've given you some low-cost tools here. Okay, but I encourage you get your team together, and this is a great way to visually show what your problems are. And now I'm standing in the way of lunch, so I feel a little anxious. But you guys, I'll be here all day, so if you have questions for me, and you know, please feel free to reach out to me at Ohio State. Thanks, Eric.